Good morning. Welcome you to worship this morning, you who are in this space and you who are worshiping from other spaces on the radio or online. Welcome you to worship. We are so glad you are here. If you're on Facebook Live, it'd be fun to hear where you are. You can introduce yourself and share the peace later on. We celebrate Holy Communion, and all you who are gathered here and wherever you are gathering are welcome to the meal. So we begin worship with a centering song, and we do that because you've already had a busy morning. You have lots on your mind. It's not an easy thing to get to church in the morning. So we put this time into worship, this centering song, to give you some pause to prepare your hearts and your minds for worship. Please join in the call to worship. In a world of unbelief, we set aside this time to connect with faith. We come carrying worries and fears, losses and dreams, ready that we may open our hearts to God's grace. We come bearing the stresses of our week and conflicting concerns, ready that we may open our minds to God's word. We come feeling overwhelmed and unsure of ourselves, with too much to manage and too little hope, ready that we might open our lives to God's Spirit. We come as we are, to be embraced as we are by God's eternal love. Worship begins where your faith with God begins, where your life with Jesus begins and does not end. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sins, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We'll pause for a moment of reflection between you and God. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Hear these words of forgiveness and freedom. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Please stand as you may, and our processional hymn is Arise, Your Light Has Come. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy Jesus, you sent many into the world to proclaim your kingdom on earth. Send us, equip us, and walk with us so that everyone can learn of your abundant love. Amen. Please be seated. If you're just tuning in, we welcome you worshiping over the radio and Facebook. Your assisting minister is Chris Hertler, and preaching is Pastor Mary Wiggins.
Let us read from the psalm responsively. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord.
Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem.
Jerusalem built as a city that is bound firmly together.
To it the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, as was decreed for Israel, to give thanks in the name of the Lord.
For there the thrones for judgment were set up, the thrones of the house of David.
Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper in love of you.
Peace be within your walls and security within your towers.
For the sake of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be within you.
For the sake of the house of the Lord, our God,
I will seek your good.
Good morning, everyone. We have quite the long lesson for today here in Mark 6. A few notes before we hear our lesson. This lesson is a little bit more gritty, you could say, than other lessons. So if you are more of the sensitive type or very visual, and after the lesson just need to step out for a minute and check back in, that's okay. So a little listener discretion advised, as this lesson is could be a little intense for some, and that's totally all right there. And also, there are a lot of people with the same name in our lesson, and so to straighten a few of those folks out, we got a lot of Herods in our lesson. The King Herod that is mentioned is one of the many sons of Herod from the Christmas story. So if you hear Herod, this is his son. For those with the crucifixion and our Easter story, it's the same guy there, but not the one from the Christmas story. And a lot of people in that family are also named Herod, and I wonder why, if that tells us something about the characteristic there of Herod the man. And so we've got Herodias, the wife of Herod Antipas, and a daughter that's also named Herodias. And if you're just fascinated by that family, they're historical people, you can check that out on your own research. And so those are my notes this morning to help us enter into our story. I invite you to rise as you are comfortable. Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that's been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is it not this carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. And then he went about among the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. And he said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. And if any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed them with oil, many who were sick, and cured them. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, "John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him." But others said, "It is Elijah." And others said, "It's a prophet like ones of old." But when Herod heard of it, he said, "John, whom I've beheaded, has been raised." For Herod himself had sent men to arrest John, bound him and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, "It's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers for the leaders of Galilee. And when his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she was pleased, and his guests. And the king said to the girl, "Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it." And he solemnly swore to her, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What should I ask for?" And she replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." The king was deeply grieved, and yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. And he went and beheaded him in prison, and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl. And then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The Gospel of our Lord. As a lover of history and theater and cinema, the conclusion of today's lesson seems very familiar to me. It is all the makings of a Greek tragedy. Herod reminds me of all sorts of characters, like Macbeth from Shakespeare, or Jabba the Hutt from Star Wars, or even Regina George. And the whole story seems like something from HBO, including its shocking cliffhanger. It leaves us at the end. It's a tale as old as time, but not in a good way. This story is terrible. It makes us wonder, why in the world is this part of the good news of Jesus Christ? If only we could ask the author of Mark. We have a politician with little backbone and questionable morals, a young daughter who's used as entertainment for her father and his friends, a child used by her mother to get revenge on a man who questioned her morality. And then there's John the Baptist, who's been getting popular for doing and saying the right thing, doing the work of God, who is then killed in a horrible way and is treated no different than a prized buck on a wall. And it ends with us all in the tomb wondering, what in the world just happened? Where is the goodness in all of this? One could say that this is just an illustration of how the way things were back then. And yeah, the world and life back then were, in the words of Thomas Hobbes, nasty, brutish, and short. But this is not just a historical issue. As we know, there are still horrible things in our world. Bad things still happen to innocent people. The thirst for power is a very real thing. And the desire to save face around our friends, or to do outlandish things for the people that we love. And children, unfortunately, can be manipulated and even harmed by their parents. And brave people die as a result of less brave people's actions. Our world is a litany of tragedy. And like Jesus, many of us face disappointment and rejection from our friends, our family, and others. We're left at the tomb. And we have these moments sprinkled throughout our lives. And in those moments, we wonder if this is all that there can be. Spoiler alert, it's not. We may think something is the end, but it's not, both in the story and in our lives. In my opinion, even though I did say this lesson is long, Mark 6:29 is not even the real end of our passage for today. I think our lectionary has done us a bit of a disservice by stopping there. And I say this because there's an important part missing here. And that piece that we did not hear is one of those places where we can find a snippet of good news in this familiar terribleness. The verse right after today's passage says, "The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught." The death of John the Baptist is part of what scholars call a Markan sandwich. This explanation of previous events is inserted in the middle of a recounting about the deeds of Jesus. Right before it, Jesus sends out his disciples, and they go and they do amazing things in his name. Amazing deeds which then garner the attention of Herod. And then we get this horrible story. But then from the tomb, we hear about how the disciples return to share with Jesus the mission that is being done in his name. Even after rejection, disappointment in the empire's worst, the work of Jesus was being done. Sickness cured, demons being cast out. The kingdom of God was drawing near. Horrible things may happen from time to time, and people can do their worst to us and others, and we may fail at what we set out to do. But that does not silence the work of God. It won't stop us from being able to experience the tangible signs of the freedom we can find in Jesus Christ. Because even the greatest powers and worst events cannot stop the power of Christ. For the power of Christ is so great it causes the mighty to tremble. The power of Christ is so great it challenges our expectations of how the world should work. The power of Christ is so great that it leads us from the tomb to places of abundant life. We may not hear it in our lesson for today, but the gospel does carry on. The story doesn't end at John's tomb. After Jesus' disciples go back to report their work, Jesus then does some work of his own. He hosts his own banquet, which is very different from Herod's, miraculously feeding the multitudes that follow him with only a few fish and some bread, using his great power to give compassion and life to those who long for it. As we have and will continue to see, Jesus' power is very different from the power and authority which Herod uses and our world loves. For Herod, these are precious commodities he must hold on to at all costs. But Jesus' position is not one he's afraid to lose, but will freely give up, even at the cost of his own life. Herod uses his power for himself and to put others down. Jesus' great power doesn't kill or destroy, but nourishes, heals, restores, and liberates. Herod's banquet was one of death. Jesus' table is one in which we all find life. The story doesn't end with the terrible. There are times when we think death has won and that all hope is lost, and we wonder where the good could be in all of this. But at the edges, we find Jesus and are reminded that it is not the end. And as we know, the story doesn't even end at Christ's tomb. Even rejection and death did not stop the work and life-saving mission of God. The power of Christ conquers it all. And through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, we're reminded of God's steadfast presence with us through our messy, complicated, and sometimes terrible world. The power of Christ is seen in the resurrection, reminds us that the life-giving gospel is living, active, and draws near, even in the face of that which is incomprehensible. Where there is death, we also find life. Where we think there's an end, God sees part of the larger story of the good news of God in Jesus Christ. And this may sound familiar, but it is a story that we should remember most of all. Amen.
Thank you.
Together, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Last week, you held your annual meeting, and you elected new officers to your council and your endowment fund. So each time we elect new officers, new committee members on endowment and council, we install them. That is to say, we give them a blessing, and we each make promises to support one another in the ministry. So I'll invite, I think maybe it's just you, Angie, to come on up at this service. Angie Rabbit is serving on your endowment fund. Also newly elected are Jerry Myers, who's a new council deacon, Amy Erickson, and Kevin Kallenbach, who are both part of the endowment committee. So come on up here. You'll join me by the font, because that's a good spot to do that. Next week, you have another installation in your congregation as you install your brand new associate pastor. So 2 weeks of installations. It's very exciting. So let me tell you a bit about what we're doing. The following people have been elected by you to positions of leadership: Angie Rabbit, who's here, Jerry Myers, Kevin Kallenbach, and Amy Erickson. We give thanks for their willingness to serve. In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God, and we rejoice now that these sisters and brothers in Christ will lead us in our common life and our mutual mission as a congregation. You, Angie Rabbit, have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. You are to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith bear witness to God, who gathers us into one with the whole church. You are to seek to involve all members of this congregation in worship, learning, service, and witness and support, so that the mission of Christ is carried out into this congregation, in the wider church, in this community, and in the whole world. You are to be faithful in your specific area of serving, that the Spirit who empowers you may be glorified. And you are to be an example of faith, active in love, fostering peace, harmony, and mutual understanding in this congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, will you accept and faithfully carry out these duties of the offices to which you have been elected? If so, say, I will, and I ask God to help me. Thank you. People of God, I ask you now, will you support all of your newly elected leaders? Will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all the baptized? If so, say, we will, and we ask God to help us. We will, and we ask God to help us. I now declare you and the others installed as part leaders of the endowment and the council. Almighty God, bless you and direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be a faithful servant of Christ. Amen. Let's thank Angie. We'll continue with the prayers of the people.
One in the communion of saints and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer.
You gather your people into the body of Christ. Where your church is wounded, heal it. Where it is right, strengthen it. Where it is broken, make it whole. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
From before the foundation of the world, you are God. Revive ecosystems destroyed by human greed. Curb our desire to put wealth ahead of the health of all who call this planet home. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Your Son, our Savior, is the giver of hope and light. Bring healing to those in need. hope to any in despair, and comfort to the dying. We pray especially for those whom we name now in the quiet of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
This world cries out to you in turmoil and war. Your steadfast love and strength never fail. We pray for an end to the unrest in the Red Sea, for war in the Middle East and Ukraine to end. Lead the way, Lord, so the world will cry out to you in peace and thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. You send your Spirit into this community of faith. Thank you for raising up leaders to share their time and energy to carry out the mission of living in service to Christ. Nurture our partnerships with other community organizations, including Aspire ND. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Let all peoples praise you, O God. We give you thanks and praise for the lives of our loved ones who now rest in you. In the fullness of time, gather us with all your saints in light. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please stand as you may. Receive the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace be with you, Lyle. I invite you to stand as you may and sing the offertory hymn as the ushers bring the gifts to the table.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Indeed, right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks. He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. For those of you worshiping over the radio or Facebook, we encourage you now to share the meal with one another. Or if you happen to be by yourself, these are words for you. This is the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. In this space, you can make your way to the center aisle, just following the folks ahead of you. You'll come up the center aisle, making two lines, fill the rail all the way from the end to the middle, and after you receive the sacrament, back to your seat up the side aisle. If you need a gluten-free wafer, just let us know, and the grape juice is the white juice in the middle of the tray, and the rest of it is red wine. You are welcome at this meal, at Jesus' abundant banquet, where you will meet the mercy of Christ. Come as you are.
Thank you.
Receive this blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. Our post-communion song, let's sing together, O Lord, now let your servant.
Let us pray. Giver of every gift, Christ's body is our food and we are Christ's body. Raise us to life by your power for the benefit of all and to your glory now and forever.
Amen. I'll point out just a few announcements, but lots of things coming up. This Wednesday is what we call the Agape Festival, so that's a gathering for all generations to come. We do lots of fun stuff all over the building, and there's a meal downstairs. If you'd like to just come and share a meal, if you don't want to eat alone this week, just come and there'll be lots of company that day. If you have neighbors or grandkids, maybe they don't come to church, but you just want them to experience the love of Christ, just bring them. You don't need to sign up. It's a one-night thing we do together. A week from today, again, is your next installation, so I know there's something else going on next Sunday, but you can come and celebrate the touchdown of the Holy Spirit, the call process. So come, it'll be a very exciting day when we get to, with our bishop, be a part of the installation for Pastor Mary Wiggins. Notice on the back of your bulletin the time for Lenten worship, which begins in a couple of weeks. We start Lent. Ash Wednesday is the usual, 12, 10, and 7 p.m. We do that service two times. And then after that, worship is at 5:30, and the meal right after. We thought we could maybe get you home a little bit earlier, so we moved worship up for the rest of the Wednesdays in Lent. If you do not like to drive, even at 5:30, but you really want to be there, please call the church office and we will find a ride for you. That service will be live streamed all the Wednesdays, but if you want to be here and you can't drive, just let us know. On the other side of that coin, if you know anybody who maybe isn't comfortable driving at night, please call them and invite them to worship because it is hard to ask for a ride. And last year we began this common read practice together, so you might like reading books, and then you wish you had somebody to talk to about what you read. So at the same time, we encourage you to read this book called The In-Between, and the person who suggested the book is going to introduce it on the video.
Good morning. I'm Lainey Haroff, and while I really wish I could be with you guys this morning, I am currently acting as retreat cook for the Badlands Ministries Winter Crafting Retreat. But I am so excited to be able to announce the book for the upcoming Common Read. We'll be reading The In-Between by Hadley Vlahos. Hadley is a hospice nurse, and she's written a book all about her experiences as a hospice nurse and the life lessons that have been gifted to her from her patients as a hospice nurse. I became familiar with Hadley through social media and have been following her content for a while. And so when she announced that she'd written a book, I pre-ordered it, I read it right away, and it was easily the best book that I had read in 2023. So I am so excited to be able to read this book with you guys for our common read and to enjoy a really robust discussion that I'm sure is going to accompany that. We will be doing a discussion on this book on April 7th, and the church has copies of the book that you can borrow. So reach out to the church office to borrow the book. And I am really looking forward to reading this book with you guys. I will be rereading it because I cannot wait to read it again. And I'm just looking forward to the discussion. So have a great morning and go grab your book.
And you can actually go find your book really quickly if you happen to know where the bust of Martin Luther is in the Commons area. If you don't, it's somewhere on the other side of that wall. You can go pick up your book and read that. And again, we'll talk about it in April. Please stand as you may for one last blessing. And then we'll sing the first two verses of our sending hymn. Receive the benediction. God who names you, Christ who claims you, and the Holy Spirit who dwells in you, bless you and remain with you always. Amen. Sing verses 1 and 2 of O Living Bread from Heaven.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.